Thank you very much. I would first take this opportunity to thank EPFL and AI Crowd to give me this opportunity to talk here. All the other speakers or talks that we have seen today, they almost talk about what we can do with the nutrition and with the food. This research usually will talk about one step back. So before doing all the cool stuff, first we have to know what we are eating, right? So I'll start with that note and moving forward. So motivation. So as last presentation taught that most of the deaths are happening mostly because of the obesity and overweight. So yes, greater risk to morbidity and mortality, worse than having unsafe sex and alcohol, drug and tobacco use combined. And last this 20th century, we have seen that dishes are growing, people are making more and more sweet dishes and salted dishes and everything, and as a result, weights are increasing. And last in COVID situation also, people are working from home, eating and not exercising. I am a good example for that. And this whole situation has been like going down the hill because of eating and stuff. So what we can do, what can we do about it? So first thing, research has shown that if we log our foods regularly, then somehow it plays with our conscience that okay, we start to eat, we need to start eating healthy. So people have started to start their logging in the food diaries, but the problem is that it's difficult to summarize. So you have to have a photographic memory if you want to know like how many sweet dishes have you eat in the whole month or something, and you have a lack of information at the very end of month or something. So what can we do about it? Also, with the motivation, the bad thing is that it's sort of plays a role like a time decay function. So today I am very much motivated to log five meals or whatever total food items I ate, but after 10 days, okay, no, I don't want to log anymore because it's time consuming and I don't know where the diary is. So we developed the food application, and with the help of your smartphone, you can just take a picture, and lot of different application will tell you that what food items you're eating. So I guess everyone sitting here, mostly people uses this fitness app or something. They all have this system enabled in their device, but there are certain problems. So previous work. So as I mentioned, so food logging is an important thing, and scientists have been working on the same problem for past 20 years. And moving with the time, people started with a very simple shape-based approach, texture-based approach, color-based approaches, local similarities, global similarities, and something. As you can see, like people have been trying on different data sets. Some people are trying on only certain number of categories. This UNIMIP 2016 is a open source data set that has been released, but the problem is that it's more of a laboratory setting data set. So you have a plate and everything, every food item that is placed there, it's almost segmented, and the picture quality is already high, with a high resolution. So the problem is already solved. So, but we usually don't eat like that. We have a small plate, and in that we put a lot of food stuff, which makes the algorithms difficult to find out what exactly is there. Similarly, we have other data sets that has been released over time. This UEC Food Picks did complete. It's a very good data set. The problem is that it's mostly contains the rice based diets, but which usually is good in Asian countries. The data set is coming from Japanese, but in Europe we usually don't eat too much rice, but there's more of a bread related diet thing. So what we came up with the I mean the EPFL and AI Crowd has come up with the data set, a benchmarking data set that it's called My Food Repo. So they have they've bring together a cohort of people where people have agreed to give their pictures, food images to the world for further research, and the project started on July 7, 2018, and till 2020 we have collected nearly 24,000 images with 39,000 segmented food items. So why segmentation? Because we also wanted to know how much a person is eating, not just what he is eating. So going towards the segmentation is one of the first steps in knowing how much. So what else? We have 273 food, different food classes, which covers almost every diet that a person takes in the whole Europe. So mostly contains the Mediterranean diet, and each annotation, I mean each class has nearly 35 annotations. This data set is now updated more in 2022. So now we have approximately 40,000 images with 323 classes. So enhanced data set, and now we have 200 annotations per class. This is the public data set that other researchers can try their algorithms on. And we have also a private data set that we don't share with the public, and that will be used as benchmarking for later use. So these are some of the pictures. As you can see, not too much easy because food items comes with different colors, texture, and every other thing. So recognizing them, it's always a very first thing, very difficult. You can see the first glance, like water can be placed in different directions or in a very different placement things. Same goes with the apple. Apple seen the front from the top, and if you cut it, the apples. These are some of the examples. Now the classes. So the data set was released in three different phases, and the first phase came up only with top 40 classes, and then they released another data set with 61 classes, and then 270 classes, and today now the data set has been released with 323 classes. This right. So we humans have a lot of preference when we eat food. So some people want to have sweet or dessert along with the along with their food. Some people prefer to eat dessert with the food. So every person has their own preference, but there are some preferences which are quite global. For example, whenever there's a salad, there's a high probability that there's a tomato in the salad. Same goes with the bread and butter and other things. It's highly unlikely to eat bread in the morning with a beer or something. So the correlation is quite, doesn't work in that case. So now we know that the problem is, and we need to solve it. But there are certain challenges that we have to deal with. For example, there are certain food items which are preferred over other food items. So a person doesn't eat chocolate too much, but he eats a normal diet every day. So that's why we see this class imbalance here. So 15 categories takes almost 35% of the annotations. So there are we have to deal with this type of challenge as well. Another challenge is that different demographics have different food items, and most of them looks same. So this coffee with caffeine almost looks exactly same as white coffee with caffeine. So there are this bread whole wheat and bread whole meal, they look almost similar. So the CNN based approach or any other approaches which uses vision as their features, so it get confused which of the food categories, which one. Other thing is that we also quite eat overlapping food. For example, whenever we have pasta, we have sauce on top of it. So sometimes people eat a lot of sauce on the pasta, and we don't, I mean, the picture doesn't show the pasta underneath it, and we only see the sauce. So there are certain problem, and you can also see one example which has like a bread on top of it, there's a cheese. So looking at this, even for human, it gets difficult to identify like which type of bread it is underneath the cheese. Another challenge is that we have partial annotations. Since all the annotations have been human seen, although but still on each plate there are some items which cannot be named, at least by me. When in here or here also, I mean, in all the lunch, I don't know mostly 50% of the food. So if somebody asks me to annotate the food item, I won't be able to. So I'll annotate only those food items which I know. So partial annotation, these things makes the model always challenging to identify these pictures. So AI Crowd working with EPFL works in this ecosystem. So we have this My Food Repo app. Patient takes images from their mobile phone. It goes to a food recognition API where the food items are recognized with these with this image, and then it goes to the annotators, human annotators. They annotate the image, check the predictions with data generated with the model. So if there's wrong prediction, they'll correct it. If there's incomplete predictions, incomplete annotations, they'll annotate more. And then this image along with the annotation goes to two different data sets, public and private. Public data set goes to AI Crowd community, where a lot of people from all over the world tries to figure out the models, best models to solve the whole problem, and based on it, based on putting some incentives on the challenge, we get leaderboard, and we test those models on private data, and then we the highest performing model goes to the food image recognition API. So this whole ecosystem works. It's been working for past 2 years, and it's continuously going with the same thing. And all the state of the art instance segmentation models, whenever they come, participants try to achieve best performance on that. And food recognition API tries to recognize more food items. So method, it's a simple, I mean, I put anatomical architecture of the whole problem. So we have a food plate, and then this is a CNN based instance segmentation architecture. So on the first stage, we have this backbone, usually contains FPN, that is feature parameter network, or RFP, recursive feature parameter, and now there are more transformer-based approaches also. So these first stage tries to look at the image and tries to find the local and global features, visual features, and tries to come up with the proposals. Like for example, in the RPA network, you can see there are some boxes. So step one has propose that, okay, there are certain things there. I don't know what it is, but there are certain things. So RPN tries to find out, okay, if the thing that you have identified, is it food or not? So there's a objectness network, RPN, very small. And then there's a parallel network, which gives you the classification, the bounding box, and the masking. And the result, you can see there's a burger, potatoes, and some peas, I guess. So the methods that have been used in this whole ecosystem so far. So mask RCNN is one of the first instance segmentation algorithm. It uses FPN backbone, the backbone that I showed, that is a stage one, RPN, and heads. So simple heads, classification, regression, and masking. And then the few years later, a new approach came. It's called Cascade RCNN. It comprises of FPN backbone, same, and RPN network, but it uses a cascade head. So instead of using single head for each classification, regression, or masking, it uses three heads, and it propagates the result to make the whole prediction better. Then there's a hybrid task cascade. It's based on the cascade RCNN method. It just reinforces the flow of information between different masking heads. So it also further improves the precision in a way. And then there's a new method, detect ORS, till 2020. And now there are transformer methods. So in detect ORS, they created the whole new backbone, which is called RFP. It's based on FPN backbone, just created a few back signals to the previous layers. And then they come up with the recursive nature of the whole backbone. They uses the same cascading heads as hybrid task cascade uses, and as a result, detect ORS outperforms any other method that has been shown here. So these are those were the methods that usually work with these type of problem. But these are not the only methods. We can also try other methods. For example, training classification separately and masking separately. Many participants have tried different things, and what we can tell you that what didn't work. For example, we tried to participants tried to create a separate classification model to condition the predictions. For example, they used detect ORS to do the instance segmentation, and then using another classification model to remove the unlikely classes. So that didn't work out because the instance segmentation model already includes that part. We also tried hierarchical filtering based on food ontology, because for example, if there's a bread, there are 10 different type of breads, and based on that, if something has been predicted as bread, we try to find out which bread is mostly eaten by patients or the user. So based on that, we try to do the post process. Doesn't work. We have also seen the co-occurrences matrix. It works well for some of the classes. For example, if there's a bread with a large area, then there will be butter or at least jam with it. So one of the method, but it doesn't work with all the classes, especially when we have a large set of classes. We have also tried to put the weights on the classes, because whenever we see there's a class imbalance, people or scientists try to put the weights based on the classes, and didn't work out. So this is the evaluation. We are improving with time. So in round one, we had 40 classes with 5,000 images and 7,000 annotations, and we are using mean average precision with IOU greater than 0.5, because mostly precision, because it's okay to precision and recall. And in round two, we had this 61 classes, and as you can see, the mean average precision has been increased. And in round three, also increased, but the precision has decreased, but the number of classes have increased, so that's sort of acceptable, I guess. And in round four, the results were even better than round three. We did an ablation study to find out which technique improved the results. So we have this mask RCNN, and that has been used with the different backbones for ResNet 50, ResNet 101, and then new ResNet. So with baseline, which comes directly with the COCO dataset, we tried, it gives the lowest performance, and then participants tried to use multi-scale training where they have multiple scales of image, and then they try to ensemble the results. So that improved the baseline a bit, and then weighted loss. For example, the main task behind the whole problem is to find out what food item has been consumed and the masking. So we know that we are very less concerned with the bounding boxes, so we put higher weights to the classification loss and to masking loss. So that also worked compared to the baseline. And then test time augmentation, we tried to make prediction for one image and flip it or rotate it, and then try to ensemble the results. So that also shows an improvement, and combining, of course, all these approaches. So ResNet 50 is the smallest backbone, so obviously not given too much too good of a results, but increasing the complexity of the backbone will give you higher results. And as you can see, that hybrid task cascade gives you the best results out of every other method. And we have not shown detect ORS method ablation here, but it outperforms the HTC model as well. So in a conclusion, I would say that as a research scientist, we have contributed a data set to the community where people can create their methods and try on this data set and create new benchmarks and improve the whole food image recognition so that more scientists and other nutrition-based approaches, mental-based approaches, any other can be done so far. Because if this pipeline doesn't work very well, for example, if it works only 20% or 30% of the time, then anyway, doing further research won't matter a lot. Because first we need to find out what person is eating and then we can intervene in between the whole process. The data set has, it's not biased. So the cohort is selected very well. And the benchmark has attracted nearly 1,000 participants from over 71 countries. So the methods that I've shown, they've come from very different approaches, doing multiple experiments and winning the competition after that. So our contribution is that we have given the dataset, public dataset, freely, and it's open source with the CC by 4.0 license. The code is open source, so you guys are very much welcome to contribute and improve the baseline. Thank you very much.
Questions? So maybe I have a question. So if you want to, so for an application to epidemiological studies, for example, you would like not only to be able to recognize the food, but also to estimate the portion. So is there any work, ongoing work in that direction?
Yes, there are multiple work that has been done in the same direction, but you see the portion combines two information, which is the volumetric information and the area-based information. The segmentation will give you the area-based information because you are looking at the image from top or side, doesn't matter. But we don't have the volumetric information because the phone cameras doesn't come with 3D sensors. iPhones usually come with 3D sensors, but the image quality is really high, and to upload that sort of image again takes a time. So we'll again go back to the same problem that people will start to think that, okay, this image or this image recognition system has been eating a lot of my data, so I don't want to upload the picture. So with the 2D images, what we can do best is to get the proportions but not the portions from the whole picture. For example, if we know the dimension of the plate, which won't be too much hard to know from the image, then we can at least tell that for the whole month you have eaten 50% protein and you have eaten 20%, let's say, dairy product or some other meat-based product or something. And then at the end of the month, dietitians can actually intervene and tell that, okay, you are already suffering from obesity or type 2 diabetes, so maybe you should cut down some of your meat and fill up on your plant-based diets or vegetables or something like that. But there are more other researches. For example, I know one of the research from Food Picks Complete. So it's a Japanese-based research. So most of their food comprises of rice. So they have calculated the volume of one rice grain, and then they multiply it based on all the other rice grains that are present in the food image. It works very well with the Japanese data set, but it will not work in Swiss-based or Mediterranean-based diets. If you don't mind, I can share one more approach. So there's one more approach. It's called hand-based approach. So we tried it in one of our research projects. So whenever someone is eating food, we ask them to either put a finger or some sort of scale on the food so that we get to know the height of the food items. So once we know that, we can, with the area and the volumetric information, we can find out how much you have eaten, but it's just a very good estimate. It will not be very much accurate. But the problem is that it's not feasible. I mean, if I'm eating at a restaurant, no one can ask me, I mean, no one can expect me to put a finger or put a scale in front of everybody else sitting there. So it works well, but it's not feasible, practical use.
Thank you. More questions? Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for the talk. I wanted to ask, you mentioned that it's impossible to kind of estimate the volume, right, of the different ingredients, whatever, because the phones don't generally have sensors for that, right? But if I'm not mistaken, I think there are some computer vision algorithms that can do 3D reconstruction, where you could take the volume from by taking pictures of the object from different viewpoints.
Okay.
Do you think that could work in the future, or would be too much computational overhead and also people being lazy to take several pictures, right?
Yes, so that is one of the challenge that people, I mean, first we have to tell people, okay, you have to take different pictures from different angles. Yes, Instagrammers do that, but to get a high, good picture. But even if you do that, there are again will be certain problems. So I can give you one example. For example, assume that you are eating rice with some gravy in a bowl, and doesn't matter how many pictures you take, you can find out the volume, but you will not be able to tell the exact portion because you don't know how the food is placed, because you can only see the bowl from outside. You can see the food from top, that there is rice, but you don't know what's underneath it. So the problem is, yes, partially solvable, but not 100% solvable. But yes, in future, if we have, let's say every phone comes with 3D sensing, then at 3D sensors, then at least we will be able to give a statistical touch to the whole problem and would be able to find out the best portions that a person has been eating.
Okay, then thank you.
Thank you very much.